I now request Mr. Ajit Doval to deliver the 21st Lalit Doshi Memorial Lecture on State Security, Statecraft and Conflict of Values.
Chair of today's event, Chief Secretary Mr. Swadhin Chhatriya, distinguished members on the dais, Mr. Bharat Doshi, Mr. Bam, Mr. Arun Bongiwar, our head of the trustees group here, Ms. Pratima Doshi, Mr. Garmani, and all of the distinguished friends here. Ladies and gentlemen, I am grateful to the foundation for giving me this opportunity to come and interact with you on a subject about which the credibility or the doubts about the credibility have been seriously raised by my dear friend Mr. Baum. You would only be wondering that how much you can trust me what I say. Particularly he is telling that I'm a man of operations, so the question of conflict of values is probably, I am not the most competent person to say that. Friends, it's a great occasion for me today because we have assembled here in the memory of a great friend and a great colleague of ours, a great admirer of all of us we are, Mr. Lalit Doshi, who was one of the most promising officers, a man who in his short life had contributed a lot and probably had much more promise and potential than the country was deprived of. I had the occasion today of meeting some of his family members, and I can well understand that it must be a certain amount of a solace for them that so many of his friends, so many of his admirers still remember him and remember him with a lot of respect and reverence. As told by the Chief Secretary, I was here a few days back. That was last Thursday. It was an event of a sort in Mumbai. And in the evening, somebody tutored me a statement by an important leader. That state-sponsored killings diminish us all, reducing us to murderers. This formulation literally means that all coercive instrumentalities of the state, may it be the army in the battlefield, may it be the police killing the terrorist in Taj Hotel, may it even be a private citizen exercising his right of private defense because he is empowered by the state instrumentality of the law to exercise that, should he use his caution that deprives anybody of his life, he reduces himself to the status of a murderer. Because the formulation is very clear. State-sponsored killings. Now, what is state-sponsored here? It means is this, that is anything which has got the approval and the legal sanctity of the state diminishes us all by reducing us to murderers. I am not going into the propriety, the expediency, the correctness of the statement. But it generates a very, very important discourse. It is a discourse about the conflict of values. It is a real discourse that we should all look into very, very seriously. In introspection, a large number of us who had been in the government or even in any decision-making capacities have faced this dilemma many times. There is something which is in the public interest, in the larger interest of the nation, in the larger interest of the generations of Indians who have yet to take birth, But there are your own values, your own thinking, your own faith systems, your own beliefs. Should there be a conflict, how do you sublimate it? How do you resolve it? I recall that after September, after 9/11, September 9 in US Twin Powers attack, addressing the US Congress, President Bush had made a statement. America values its freedom. But should it come in conflict with the supreme interest of the state, the latter will prevail. That is, the freedoms which are guaranteed by the Constitution, which are sacrosanct, also will be subordinated should it come that the state has to be protected, the supreme interest of the country have to be protected. This dilemma comes in all walks of the governmental or the state's function, but it becomes particularly when it comes to the exercise of the coercive instrumentalities of the state. There has always been a talk about just wars and unjust wars, correct interventions and incorrect interventions by the foreign powers. Now, firstly, let me tell you that this dilemma is real. It is not hypothetical, imaginary, or a political posturing. This is real. This happens in the life of all those who have practiced, if I may use the word, power in one form or the other, where you are involved in decision making. Even the scriptures have addressed it and come to their own conclusions. You know, in Gita, in chapter 2, there's a very interesting verse which it deals with it. It says, what can you do when there is a dilemma? How do you resolve this dilemma? And it says, sukhe dukhe samay krata, labh labho jaya jayo, tato yuddha yuddhasya naivam paap mavapasasi. If you can bring pleasure and pain at the same pedestal, if you can bring the loss and profit at the same pedestal, victory or a defeat also at the same pedestal, that is, there is nothing for you in this. And thereafter you do whatever you have to do in the battlefield, you will be committing no sin. It is not for yourself. It is not for profit, it's not for name, it's not for fame, it's not for money, it's not for wealth, it's not for power. It is for a higher cause. And you know, even in Quran, in Surah 2, there's a verse, the holy book says that in defense of faith, millat and jamaat, and I quote it, and slay them wherever you find them, for allowing persecution by evil is worse than slaughter. Slaughter is permitted, but accepting the distinct of the evil's persecution is not. But it is not. If it is really real, why does this dilemma arise? And why does it remain unresolved today? There are three main reasons of this dilemma. The first is that the objectives of the two sets of values are entirely different. You need your personal values for your faith system, for your sublimation, for your spiritual elevation, for your material benefit. It can be anything. That is only you. You may like to go to heaven, or you may like to get some siddhi, or you may try to get some great solace or great comfort of your mind or peace or soul, whatever is that. You are pursuing it for that. Whereas the value system of the state is with the objective of protecting the society, protecting the coming generations, protecting those core values for which the society exists. So this conflict of the purpose for which the value systems are there, so there is a conflict. So in my personal life, I tell you that this dilemma arises, that is, I come from a family of Brahmins from Uttarakhand, and my family conventionally was a vegetarian family. And I happened to be posted in Northeast for 7 years and then in Pakistan for 7 years. To begin with, I didn't like to be a non-vegetarian. In any case, not that I didn't take non-vegetarian food, but then I wasn't very fond of it. But there was a time when I took only non-vegetarian, nothing else. It looked at some point of time that probably it was not something that's the right thing to do. But soon you sublimate yourself. It's a larger cause. Well, this is a very small example, but what I'm telling is that is desh kal patr ke anusar rashtr ki seva ke liye aap jo bhi karte hain, jo bhi samarpan karte hain, jo bhi sacrifice karte hain, wo manya hai. To ye ek school of thought tha ki agar should there be a conflict, should there be a clash of values, then the higher value in which you have got nothing at stake, because all your self-values have got something in it for you. Your material well-being or your intellectual well-being or your spiritual well-being, but it is for you. You are the epicenter of that value. But when you come to the question of the larger societal values, it is selfless. The second thing is that the states have been really tyrannical. It is not that the states have always been very fair, objective, humane, and correct, both internally and externally. And how do you fight that tyranny? You fight that tyranny through defiance internally and through wars externally. Now, whether it's the Nazi Germany or the fascist Italy or there is persecution by Pol Pot regime or there are Idi Amin or something like that, then there is a conflict of values. That is the very purpose which you say, who will decide what is best for the state. So that is the second cause that it arises. But there's a third reason, and which is actually the most practical reason. We say that the values of the state, but how does the values of the state manifest themselves? They are exercised by few individuals, in dictatorship or monarchies by one or two, and maybe even in democracies maybe another 200 people who are wielding real power. Leave aside the theoretical models. The recent survey of this thing, that how many people run the United States, it was 173 people. Totality who are running the state. The real power is exercised by them. And actually, the substantial strategic power is this thing by a much smaller group. That doesn't matter. But what matters is that they are all human beings. And when the decision making is done by them, they are also human beings, and they do not automatically transfer themselves from a model of an individual entity to a collective entity of a state. Now, once they are human beings, they carry with them their own prejudices, their own values, their own likes, dislikes, and also the self-interest. And therefore, the dilemma arises because of that. And that is why there have been views, very extreme views, about the morality of the state itself. Now, Mikhail Bakunin wrote a thesis about immorality of the state. He lambasted the theory of social contract. And he says the child is born and is a member of the society. You say there is a tacit social contract between him and the state. That is, he will abide by the laws of the state. State will protect him. He says this is a contract between the man who cannot speak, who cannot hear, who cannot understand, and a mighty power of the state. So this contract itself is vitiated. And then there had been Machiavelli's and others who have been distinct, who have preached on the contrary of the absolute power of the state. Thomas Hobbes, for example, he said that accepting all the autocracy, all the authority of the state is the duty of every citizen. But it evolved. It evolved into this thing that, well, democracies in different forms came. And they said the quintessence of the democracy lies that the laws by which the people will be governed will be made by them, will be executed by the people whom they elect, but will be independently adjudicated by the people who are the experts of law. And therefore, the rule of law became the quintessence of democracy. Democracy is not necessarily this thing of the ballot box. It is about that those who will make the laws will come through the process of the ballot box and will make the laws which will be binding not only on you but also on those who make it. So that is how the extreme views were tried to be reconciled. But the people who came from the ballot box to make the laws, or the executive that was elected, could not always measure up to the confidence that was reposed by the people in their ability to protect the state, its citizens, and its progeny. And that is why the dilemma gets into a state of confusion, and fundamentals are lost, and therefore we think that probably much can be said on either side. I don't think that there's much can be said on either side. Let human failings not be taken as the failings of the system or the failings of the concepts and the doctrines. Because at the end of the discussion, all thinkers have accepted one thing, and all practitioners have accepted one thing, that if human beings have to live in a community, it requires an order. And this order has got to be administered by someone. And for the sake of convenience, we call it a state, whatever the form of a state. If you become a hermit and go to this thing and you are leading a life of total isolation, probably the rules of the state may not apply to you. But if you are a social animal and living in a society, and if your conduct is going to affect my survival status, my pattern of life, then how can you have the total freedom and I too have the total freedom? How can you have this freedom to shoot and I may not have the freedom to defend myself or to retaliate? So an order will have to be made. Who will have freedoms up to what level? What are the costs and what are the responsibilities? There is another reason for that. That the citizens individually cannot protect themselves against large number of the new threats and this thing that came. It's only the collective security that can be provided to them. If you have got weapons of mass destruction or the modern wars or the nuclear weapons or the anything, terrorism, what can a single individual do against that onslaught? So the state became the necessary. But there's also another important point that, okay, like disarmament, you can't say that I believe in disarmament, so I'm throwing away my weapons when everybody else will keep it. I believe in disarmament so that I can have such a powerful weapon that I can make all of you to throw your weapons. And therefore, after I'll throw my also. But you can't have that this thing that living in the community of nations where you are being subjected by pulls, pressures, influences, by what the other nations are doing, that you are not in a position to defend yourself, to protect yourself and your people and your citizens. You can't say that somebody has got the freedom to carry on the terrorist acts against you, but you probably think that the state has got no right or a privilege to use its power, which will deprive somebody of his life. Now, when we say that state is inevitable, it is required, this organization structure is required,
then the first question that arises is, okay, what is the first duty, what is the first charge on this institution? From the time that the concept of the state and the nation state and this thing have evolved in many years, the first duty of the state has been to protect itself, is the self-defense. And that has also been the cause of large number of problems. That is, the state has to protect itself. When we say India, what is the first duty of this government of India? Is to ensure its territorial integrity, its sovereignty, core values of its constitution, security of its citizens, continuity of its institutions, protection of its civilizational and cultural values. That is the preservation, it is the protection of the self, whatever you decide as the ingredients of the self of the society. Now, in this protection of the self, the conflict of values is automatic. Because when you are protecting your rights in the defensive mode or in the defensive offense mode, conflicts are bound to arise. And those conflicts will sometimes be to my advantage and sometimes to somebody else's advantage. We will have to take the package in totality and accept it. That is, that the traffic regulation and the traffic has to move in an orderly way and there has got to be a traffic constable there, then I will have to learn to wait till my time comes. And maybe that somebody is lucky that when his time comes, the moment he reaches, there is a green light. So, asking that there will be a perfect equality at every time, in every situation, in every occasion, and making the comparisons is a logically fallacious issue. It is not sustainable, it is not tenable, it is not doable. It has never happened, it will never happen. But the system in totality must be fair and upright. Now, in the statecraft, earlier the statecraft was more confined to the question of wars. The rules of wars were made, the Vienna Convention was made, what are the permissible type of weapons which can be used, what is the type of the mines that can be laid and they cannot be laid, whether the claymore mines can be put or no more they can be put. All these things have been settled to a large extent. Prisoners of wars will be this thing. But the days of statecraft through wars is coming almost to an end. Wars are no more an effective instrumentality of achieving your political and strategic objectives in a cost-effective way. There is no guarantee that a very powerful nation with a huge arsenal, with a huge economy, with a huge intelligence capability, with a great scientific prowess, would be able to subdue even a small group of the terrorists. Whether it's the United States in Vietnam or the Soviets in Afghanistan. So people are increasingly thinking that probably it is not the most effective way. You are not able to achieve your strategic objectives through the mechanisms of war. That has evolved into the statecraft, the other institutions or the other props of the statecraft becoming quite important. In any case, the like Walzer's theory about the morality of the war itself has brought into the focus. And even most of the countries which are engaging in war have found it, that it has been unaffordable diplomatic cost for them to sustain that. So in this background, new instrumentalities like diplomacy, intelligence, perception management, your media and this thing, use of soft power, influencing the minds of the people, that have become the new instruments of the statecraft. In a way, have you ever wondered why the Americans decided to support the Islamic gun-wielding irregulars against a regular Soviet army. It had many options. When the Soviets made an entry in Afghanistan, they could have taken them militarily. They could have done their economic blockade. They could have taken it to the UN Security Council. They could have passed any resolution against them. They would have tried all means which are available to a much greater power of the world. But it resorted to something entirely different mechanism. That was the mechanism of the covert war. That is the proxy war. You are fighting against someone using somebody else's manpower, using somebody else's weapons. You fly the weapons from Egypt, which are of the Russian origin, send it to Peshawar and then distribute it to the Mujahideen, and then send them to Afghanistan. Because they found that the other means of the statecraft were unaffordable against a country which had a great strategic weapon presence. Now that is the dilemma. That this is statecraft. War is more transparent. But wars through other means which Clausewitz had defined is much more dicey and much more difficult to handle. These proxy wars, these covert wars, espionage, sabotage, subversion, influencing the minds of the people sitting in this hall. If I can make all of you think the way that I want you to think and behave, I wield a power over you. The real power in the coming times will not be wielded by those people who are going to have control over your lands, or over the technology, or over the means of production, or over the wealth. It will be wielded by people who can make you think the way that is in their interest. If I want you to buy a product and you buy that, I control your minds. If I want you to hate everything that is Indian, I want you to be ashamed of your culture and civilization. And if I achieve that, I win the battle. If you resist it and you are not able to do this thing, you win the battle. This is the battle of civilization, the battle of culture. It's basically the battle of minds. It is all by exercising through the soft powers. And statecraft has got us the new instrumentalities. Now, I think I've spoken for long, but basically I would like to conclude briefly by telling that state is necessary. And if it is necessary, protecting itself will continue to remain its supreme important role. And to perform that role, it will have to develop capabilities to protect its vital interests. And for that, it will have to employ the statecraft that is necessary to protect the state. Individual morality cannot be inflicted on the larger interest of the society and the nation, whereas the individuals must have the liberty and the freedom in their personal lives to have their liberties of following their values, but it cannot be superimposed on the larger interest of the society. There cannot be any unilateralism when the nation is threatened, and therefore the nation will have to take recourse to all means which are necessary to protect itself, not only for the present generation, but for the coming generation. The state may belong to those who are its citizens today, but the nation belongs to those who were part of this thing 1,000 years back. Maharana Pratap and Shivaji are as much part of this nation today as they were when they were alive. And the people who have to come after 1,000 years, we owe a responsibility for them. And therefore, we cannot subjugate and subordinate anything that is going to affect our long-term vital interest for the sake of these small things. So when state acts in a way which is judicial, which is fair, which is through due process of law and not for furtherance of any vested interest, its actions are totally correct and they are not murderous, and they are not that does not reduce you to the level of murderers. Let us all have the confidence and confidence to do what is right for the sake of the nation and not get confused about these artificial contraption of that there is a conflict. In reality, there is no conflict. In reality, there are parallel values in which there is a plurality of the values in which we can live, the generations have lived, and the coming generations will have to live. In a family, we live with those plural values. We have got a relationship with our elders, with our parents, with our wife, with our children. They are all decided and governed by the different set of values. So it's not one thing that you can superimpose on others, and therefore the formulation that any instrumentality, any coercive instrumentality used by the state reduces it to the status of murders is totally untenable. Thank you very much.